Welcome to lesson 3. Chances are that you've worked with Linux commands a lot already. But have you ever wondered what happens when you run a Linux command? In this lesson we'll have a look at the work that needs to be done while running a command, and you'll learn how system calls and library calls play an essential role in that. You also get to know the strace and ltrace utilities, some valuable utilities that help you figuring out which system and library calls have been issued while running a command. So let's try to understand what happens when a user opens a file. So if a user performs a simple task, a lot of things need to happen to accomplish that task. Have you ever wondered what's involved to simply read a file as what's happening when you use a command like cat etc hosts? It's not just a command, but the command needs to perform a lot of operations. So it starts with a cat command that must be read and loaded from disk in RAM. Only once it's in RAM, it can be used. Next, the related libraries must be found and loaded in RAM also. Then the etc host file needs to be located on disk, because that's what you want to read using cat. And next, the permissions of the current user need to be checked on this file as well. And if these permissions are appropriate, the file contents can be copied to RAM. Now, all of these different tasks are provided through system calls and library calls, and that is really what we need to explore in this lesson. So, system calls are an essential part of the Linux operating system. Let's have a closer look at how they are working. So, the issue is that processes cannot access the kernel directly. In order to access the kernel, system calls are defined, and these system calls are used as an interface for the processes to the kernel. So from within the process, a library function is executed to address a system call with the result that the kernel is going to do something. glibc provides this library interface to use the system calls. And common tasks like opening, listening, reading, and writing to files all involve system calls. So basically, in our previous example of what is happening when the cat command is reading contents of a file, well, basically a lot of system calls is going to happen. And I will show you that later using the strace utility. Two of the most important system calls are fork and exec. These determine how a process is starting. So we need to explore them a little bit more. So fork is what happens when the kernel creates an almost identical copy of the current process and replaces that. That's how a process starts a child process. It will first copy itself, and next it will remove its code to be replaced by the code of the child process. And then we have exec, where the kernel starts a program which replaced the current process. Let me draw that on the whiteboard for you. So let's have a look what's happening when a user types a command like ls. The starting point will be the shell, right? Because the user is typing ls from the current shell. So what is happening? The shell is going to be forked. The braces indicate that this is a system call. And basically, the forking results in a copy of the shell. But this copy of the shell needs to be removed. And in order to remove it, there is an exec system call involved. So this exec system call removes the code of the shell with the result that the ls command can be loaded. And that is how the fork and exec system calls are involved in starting commands. So system calls are documented pretty well on your Linux system. Let me start by doing man, the man page of man. You know that there are different sections in man, and what you can see here is that section number 2 is dedicated to system calls. Section number 3 is interesting as well. This is about library calls. We'll talk about those later. So the system calls are explained here as functions that are provided by the kernel. Now if you want to have a good read about these system calls, I can recommend typing man to intro. Every section of the man pages has an introduction page, and this introduction page in this case introduces the system calls. So here it explains that the system call is an entry point into the Linux kernel. And usually system calls are not invoked directly, but they have corresponding C library wrapper functions to perform the steps. And then you can see that there's a lot of other information that is included about system calls, including some related man pages as well. So if you want to have a good read about what is happening on your system, this might be a good place to start. I also like man to syscall, and there you can see some definition of what exactly this syscall is. So this is an indirect system call, and it explains what exactly is happening. Now, many system calls are existing, and they are all documented. I want to show you one more example, which is a pretty important one, about mmap. Mmap is about memory mappings. So here you can see what exactly a program needs to be doing if it needs to use this memory map system call. So here you can see the definition in the C programming language, including the arguments that this system call needs. And the result is that this system call is going to map memory for the process. You can even trace these memory mappings. So if you go to the proc file system and you pick out a process, let's hope that this is something that is really doing something. GNOME shell sounds good to me. There is a file with the name maps, and this file shows a list of all the memory mappings that have been done by this mmap system call. Now, we will explore in my upcoming demo that these system calls can be traced, and you can find out exactly what the program is doing. So when you see that certain system calls are happening, please do remember that they are pretty well documented in the man system, at least on some distributions, that is. So we have just seen how a system call provides an interface to the kernel, which is basically opening a door between user space and kernel space. Another important part of your operating system functioning is library calls. So the system calls are provided by the kernel to give access to restricted parts. Library calls come from shared libraries and provide specific functionality. There is a large number of library calls, which is virtually unlimited, because it all depends on the shared libraries that are loaded. And it's up to the programmer to create new shared libraries if they are needed for some reason. If you want to have a nice introduction to the library calls, there's a man page about it, man 3 intro, because section 3 of the man page is entirely dedicated to library calls. Let me show you what this man page looks like. So this is the intro about the library functions. It's just a generic intro for what is happening in section 3. And you can see that it describes that many of these functions are provided by libc, but they can come from elsewhere as well. I really wanted to point this intro man page out to you, because this is a really good point to get started with what your operating system is doing. And if you want to know about related items, well, just check the C also, which is providing information about some additional functionality. So we have already seen that Linux has a distinction between the user land and kernel land, and that's a very strict separation. Let's explore it a bit. So this separation has been created to restrict hardware access to the kernel only. If you want your computer to be reliable, applications shouldn't have an option to interface with hardware directly. The only interface to hardware is the Linux kernel and the drivers that have been verified and proven to work with the Linux kernel. Now, these drivers must be verified, and that is also why Linux doesn't like proprietary drivers, because the Linux kernel has no means of verifying what a proprietary driver is doing. That is why you may have heard about tainted kernels, which are kernels that contain proprietary drivers that may give you problems anyway. So the kernel provides system calls for users and processes to access hardware. As I already mentioned, there's no way for users and processes to access hardware directly. So user space is memory that is allocated by the kernel for user processes. So the kernel creates this environment, and from the user space, the processes do whatever they need to do. And within user space, different elements are running. There is, for example, network configuration. There is a services, like a web server. And there are applications, and there can be user interfaces as well. Now, to determine what a user can do from user space towards the kernel space and other parts of the operating system, users are created. Now, when you talk about users, don't think about people, but think about entities to which permissions and other limitations can be applied on the Linux operating system to define exactly what a process or a person working on your Linux system may be able to do. Every process or task running on Linux has an owner, and this owner is one of these users with the permissions that are assigned to it. Now, let me try to put all this in a drawing. So, we have the kernel. And the kernel is providing access to networking and other essential parts of the operating system, like the CPU and the disk and RAM. So, the kernel is providing an interface of the system calls to what is happening in user space. So here we have user space. And user space is basically everything that is happening on your operating system. So let's say, for example, that we have a user. This is our user. And the user wants to change the network configuration using a command like nmcli. Now, nmcli would address the appropriate system calls, and through the system calls gets to the kernel and writes configuration to the network. But hey, is this something that you want every user to be able to do? Probably not. And that is why Linux uses a system of permissions and capabilities as well, to determine what exactly a user or a process can do. Now, another example is that we have an application. Let's say we have HTTPD, a web server. Now, this web server needs to operate on the system as well, so it will address the kernel by using system calls. Now, imagine that this web server needs to be loaded, and that it needs to get CPU time, and it needs to get access to disk. Then the kernel will take care of that. It is not the web server itself that is addressing these hardware components directly. It is the kernel that's addressing these hardware components. For example, it will use a scheduler to put tasks on the CPU. It will use a memory map system call to allocate memory for this process. And it will perform I/O operations. And this is basically how we have a strict separation between what is happening in user space and what is happening in kernel land. So when we started this lesson, I explained that a lot is happening when any command is executed. If you want to find out what exactly, use strace. Strace is to trace system calls. So let me do an strace on the ls command, for example. And there you can see it went quite fast, but quite some stuff has been happening. So strace allows you, I'm still scrolling from the bottom up, strace allows you to see what exactly has been happening. For example, we see execve, which is the execution of the ls command. We see many memory maps. Here we have a memory map for ld.so.preload, which is going to access this file, which is going to open it, which is going to fstat it. And we see another memory map for something else, which needs to be opened and read and so on and so on and so on. Now, what is so interesting about this is that if you read it carefully, don't try to do it in a minute, but take your time to read it carefully. If you read it carefully, you can see exactly what your command is doing. You can see exactly what it is trying to open while it is doing so. And you can also see exactly if anything goes wrong. If for some reason it doesn't work out well, you will see a system call that is getting stalled on trying to do something. Have you ever seen those situations where you are just looking at a non-responsive command, hoping that it will give you something? Well, if you use strace, you will find out what it is waiting for. Just look for the errors and try to troubleshoot the error. Another option that I do like with strace is strace-c. Use it on any command and it will show you counters for specific system calls. Let's scroll up a little bit and you can see the percentage of time it spent on specific system calls in seconds, microseconds per call, the amount of calls, the amount of errors and the system calls themselves. This is information that can be very valuable if you want to compare the working of one command to the working of another command. Now strace is giving you so much information, it may be useful to grab on it, to figure out what is happening. If, for example, we are looking for open system calls, you would expect strace ls pipe grep open to work, right? It doesn't. And the reason is that the result that we see here on the screen is not considered standard output, it is considered standard error. So all these messages that strace is displaying is standard error. And with a pipe, you are grepping in standard output. The pipe means that the output of the first command is becoming input of the second command. Now what we need to do, we need to make sure that the standard error, which is val descriptor 2, is dealt with in the same way as the standard output. And then we can put a grep on it and you can see a list of all the opens that it has issued, including some no such file or directory messages, which can be convenient for troubleshooting. Another useful command is ltrace. Well, let me be honest, ltrace is not as useful as strace, because strace is really about system calls, and this is providing information how the command is being dealt with by the kernel and how the command is building its environment. But you can use ltrace for library information. So let's do an ltrace ls and you can see all the library calls that are issued. And if you want to browse through it, you see me using the two greater than ampersand 1 construction again, because this library trace is written to standard output as well. Now I've piped it through less and we can see exactly which library functions have been executed. Typically, ltrace is providing a lot more information, but this is not the information that is as useful as strace. But if you want to find out what your applications are doing on Linux, both utilities are extremely useful. Now let's talk about signals. A signal provides a software interrupt, and that's a method to tell a process that it has to do something. Signals are strictly defined, and you can see in man 7 signal a complete overview of all the signals that have been defined. Some signals, such as sick kill and sick term, cannot be ignored. Others can be ignored. Also, you will notice that some signals always have the same function, and other signals are specific to a command. So it's up to the programmer how he wants to deal with a specific signal coming in. Let me show you how you can work with signals on the command line. So let me first show you man 7 signal. This is an explanation of signal. And the interesting thing in this man page is right here. So this is the list of signals that have been described in the original POSIX standard. POSIX is the standard that defines how Unix distributions should work, and this is still something that is highly respected in a Linux environment as well. So there's a couple of signals that you probably already know. SIGHUB, for example. That is what we did previously to have a process reload its configuration. Or have you ever done kill minus 9? Well, kill minus 9, you can see the value in the column, and the 9 is right here. So you are sending the SIG kill signal to kill a signal in a brutal way. And there is SIG term, which is signal 15, which is the normal termination signal. And apart from that, there can be other signals that can be used as well. And that's up to the discretion of the programmer. Now let me show you an example of one of those other signals. Let me start the DD command. And I'm using DD because I know that DD is doing something with the user 1 signal. So I'm starting a background job that is copying nothing to nowhere. And if we do kill dash s for signal user 1 on PID of DD, it will find the DD command, and user 1 in this specific command will tell you how far it is doing its job. And as you can see, it's being pretty fast, copying nothing to nowhere. And this is what you need to know about signals for now. We'll encounter them later because they are an important means of interrupting a process and telling a process to stop whatever it's doing.